If you saw her on the street, you would think there's absolutely nothing wrong with this kid, and she got diagnosed with one of the most deadly brain cancers out there. Hi, I'm Jenny Ihlenfeldt. I have two daughters, a 14-year-old named Kaley and an 11-year-old named Aubrey.
And I'm Chris Ihlenfeldt, and we live in Kenosha, Wisconsin. In May 2020, Kaley started experiencing some headaches and nausea, so we had taken her to the pediatrician, and they had kind of ruled out COVID or anything like that. After a week of her not getting any better, we took her to the ER. They did an MRI. They found the mass in her brain.
It was like kind of waves of trauma every week or so, having another traumatic impact. Once we had the final diagnosis, basically they sat Chris and I down and was like, your kid has 9 to 18 months to live. Only 5% of kids will live beyond 2 years. How do you tell that to your kid? She's 8, she wants rainbows and butterflies and unicorns and to play with her sister.
After the diagnosis, she actually had surgery to remove as much of the mass as they could. After they removed the mass, they came up with a care plan, and so she went through 6 weeks of radiation.
You earned it.
Following that radiation, we essentially had a couple of options. You're just trying to talk to anyone and everyone. We reached out to Rush down in Chicago, MD Anderson down in Texas, St. Jude's down in Memphis. We sent something out to Children's of Hospital out in Boston, I believe. The second opinions essentially all pointed to the same general clinical trial. It's challenging to make sure that they have a spot for you. One of them was the clinical trial that we ended up getting into, and was C.S. Mach Children's Hospital in Ann Arbor, where she started making trips to Michigan about every 9 to 12 weeks.
You know, we live in Wisconsin. Our trial is out of Michigan. It's about a 6-hour drive through Chicago traffic. And you know, it's Wisconsin, so it snows. So it's been tough.
Patients with diffuse midline glioma have really limited treatment options outside of clinical trials. The majority of drugs don't cross the blood-brain barrier, so they don't get to the brain tumor. For our patients with midline glioma, the tumor is specifically in the middle parts of the brain, the thalamus, the brainstem, areas that are absolutely essential for survival, breathing, talking, walking. What we saw in the lab was that when we treated K27M tumor cells with ONC201, the cells differentiated more, they were a little bit more like normal brain cells.
She's been on ONC201 and they haven't seen any recurrence or growth on her MRIs, and she's still taking it. She's been on it for 4.5 years. ONC201 has kept this demon at bay.
Kaylee's doing great. Freshman in high school, she's participating in extracurricular activities just like any high schooler would, and you hope they would. So she's in the drama club. She'll play softball this spring. She's living a normal ninth grader life, and she's really enjoying high school.
I would say that funding cancer research needs to be a priority because it's everywhere. A lot of people in Congress have children in their lives. Imagine, you know, they don't get to go to their first middle school dance because they got cancer.
The patient advocacy and family communities have been involved in the FDA approval. There were a lot of family foundations that advocated directly to the FDA. Those experiences for this DIPG and DMG community were really important to the FDA. They told us that they take strongly the experience of the community and the advocacy that they were seeing.
Ensuring that we have the proper funding and resources and people in place to support these programs is just critical. I mean, it sounds cliched, but it literally saves lives.